for kickoff on a perfect day in Pasadena. Let's take a look at the weather. 70 degrees. Doesn't get much better than that in early September here in Southern California. Before we kick it off, let's bring in our third member, Chris Buck.
Thanks, Joe. Well, UCLA has indefinitely suspended Ishmael Adams following an arrest last week for suspicion of felony robbery. Now, Marcus Rios will start at that cornerback position. He had won that out during the fall. But this will primarily affect the Bruins in their nickel package and primarily in the return game. Jim Mora told us that he will use a couple guys in that position. You'll see Mossy Johnson back there, Randall Goforth. Joe, you might even see linebacker Miles Jack back there.
Yeah, I know they've used him some during camp. Be interesting to see if they do put him back there to return kicks. We'll have to wait a little bit to see because Jim Mora elects to defer and give Virginia the football first. Boy, he's been incredible in his time here at UCLA. Three straight seasons of at least 9 wins for the first time in program history. Smoke Mizell goes back there with Albert Reed, and we are ready for football in this ACC Pac-12 matchup from the Rose Bowl. And coming out of the end zone is Reed. Back to the 15, that is where Virginia will get it started. And Brady Quinn, give us three things we need to know when Virginia's got it.
Well, finally, they've got some stability at quarterback, and Matt Johns, again, a guy who provided a spark a year ago versus UCLA. And it's Smoke Mizell out of the backfield and the slot wide receiver. He's going to be a guy they're going to be looking to go to early and often. And Miles Jack moving from outside linebacker now to inside linebacker. He'll be making plays all over the field today. A very athletic player, formerly a two-way running back and linebacker. So he's found a home here at the linebacker position.
He's part of a really talented group on defense under first-year coordinator Tom Bradley. So Virginia begins from the 15. And it is Smoke Mizell up to the 19-yard line, falling to the 20 and a gain of 5. And second down and 5 coming up for Virginia.
Virginia's really wanted to get back to the power running game. That's something we talked about with the coaches all week. They felt like they played it with a little bit too much finesse last season. And they just wanted to get back to running the football downhill. They felt like that was where they were best on offense.
They've got an improved offensive line they hope to help lead the way for Mike London's offense. He's in his 6th season. Took over after winning an FCS title at Richmond. And some issues with the stadium game clock. This ACC crew will try and figure out.
The play clock will be kept on the field. The clock is not working.
I see you throw that into the mixer for these two first-time starting quarterbacks.
First times for everything, right? Season openers, there's always something that goes a little bit haywire.
And Johns again did start 3 games last season after Grayson Lambert went down with the injury. The redshirt junior from just outside of Philadelphia, though, won the job in the spring, forcing the transfer to Georgia for Grayson Lambert. And the outright starter for the first time.
And Matt Johns really brings a lot of versatility to that quarterback position. He's a little better passing than Grayson Lambert was a year ago, at least versus UCLA. But the other thing is he's a little more athletic. He scrambles outside the pocket.
He goes out of the gun for the first time on 2nd and 5. And here's Taquan Mizell, who gets the touch on the first 2 Virginia plays and breaks tackles for a first down to the 30. This is a former 5-star recruit for the Cavaliers, who has not had an opportunity to be the featured guy until now.
Yes, Smoke Mizell has taken some time to really fit into this UVA system. They've been able to find him out of the backfield in the slot. They're going to use him multiple ways today, and he's so capable once he gets outside catching the football. That's where he's most dangerous. He actually comes back to UVA this season as the leading receiver. You're going to see a lot of Smoke today.
Yeah, among all junior running backs in the country, nobody has more career catches and Mizell. And this time, penetration from that UCLA defensive line shuts it down. It was Kenny Clark leading the way.
Kenny Clark and Eddie Vanderdoes, 2 of the tough, stout run stoppers inside. And why are they most effective? Because they get penetration. They play with low pad level, and they're able to get into the backfield and disrupt the running game, putting now 2nd and long for UVA. Not the position you want to be in for an inexperienced quarterback. You'd like to keep it within 2nd and 5, 2nd and 6, so his 3rd down's more manageable.
They've rotated going under center and back in the gun. And on 2nd and 12, Johns in the shotgun. Here's Mizell trying to get outside, but Jaleel Wadu, who's off to a good start in this game, came up from the safety spot, limited him to a gain of four, and sets up third down and eight.
And I suspect as the crowd starts to get into the game here, new defensive coordinator Tom Bradley will start to turn up the pressure. He really felt at Penn State he didn't have the explosiveness on offense to be able to take a lot of chances in case things didn't work out with the blitz. Well, now they have that here at UCLA with all the talent they have on the offensive side of the ball. Expect him to bring some pressure against Johns today.
On third down, they back off and bring just four, and Johns over the middle has Kaden Severin coming off a breakout season, and he's got his first catch of 2015 for 16 yards to convert.
Kaden Severin, the leading wide receiver returning for UVA, and something that Matt Johns talked about in particular before the game was just his comfort with finding Kaden Severin on critical situations on third and down. And you can see Matt Johns getting excited. He's starting to feel a little bit of the flow of the game now.
Best friends and roommates, those two guys. And Severin going to play this play without his mouthpiece. You saw it fall on the turf. He just picked it up. On the 49 out of an empty set. Johns over the middle, has a completion to Mizell inside the 35 and swung down by Kenny Young after 17 yards, and they're getting Mizell involved early.
They're getting Mizell involved early, but really that play was all about Matt Johns moving in the pocket. And that's what separated him from Grayson Lambert to me watching last year's game versus UCLA is Matt Johns uses his feet, is able to step up inside and then find Mizell over the middle. You can give pressure to a quarterback, but if he's able to adjust and dump down to get big gains like that, it hurts you on defense.
Mizell again. We've talked about how you figure Virginia is going to try and use that power run game, but you wonder if they're going to be able to against the interior of the UCLA defense.
Yeah, the interior of the UCLA defense is very active. We talked about Eddie Vanderdoes and Kenny Clark, Tack McKinley up front. They're a bit undersized out on the edges, but those two stout guys inside are really what gives a lot of push and take up some of those offensive linemen to allow Miles Jack and Kenny Young, the inside linebackers, to make a lot of plays.
Albert Reed comes into the game as a Wildcat quarterback, and the Maryland transfer gets bottled up. Not much doing. Again, right into the teeth of that UCLA defense. Aaron Wallace and Kenny Clark combine, and it's third down.
You can see UCLA's defensive interior linemen are able to get off the ball, shed blocks. That's because they use their hands very well to separate themselves. They're able to gobble up Albert Reed and the Wildcat.
See what Tom Bradley goes to on third down and eight. They bring just four. It's a screen. It's Reed trying to use his blocks to get to the 25. He's a couple of yards short. Kenny Clark coming over from his interior defensive line position to make the tackle. And the field goal team comes out for Virginia.
And even though they don't convert, they don't get the first down, that's still a pretty solid drive. Driving down, giving your offense the ability to score points on the road. Something that UVA has struggled with lately on this 10-game losing streak they've been on.
It's a 42-yarder for Ian Fry. And he's now made 22 in a row from inside of 45 yards in Virginia. Offense has been an issue over the last few seasons for Mike London's team. They get points on possession one. UCLA's offense debuts after this. That opening drive, 10 plays, 60 yards, and a field goal.
Yeah, and you can see how excited he is commanding the offensive line, telling them good job with protection. UCLA brought a couple five-man pressures there, but really not much pressure on Johns, and he was able to elude it when there was.
Devin Fuller is the answer to the question that we asked right off at the top, and that is who returns kicks with Ish Adams suspended indefinitely. Dylan Sims hits a line drive away from him into the back of the end zone. And the Josh Rosen era starts at the 25. Give us three things we need to know.
If there's ever a time to start a true freshman quarterback, it's now at UCLA with all the talent and depth around him. He'll be handing the ball off a lot today, looking for Paul Perkins in the passing and running game. He is the Pac-12 leading rusher from a year ago. And on UVA's defense, Quinn Blanding, the outstanding true freshman, led the country in tackles. He's going to be all over the field today making plays.
It was second.
Led his team last year.
I know what you meant. He's part of a defense that has to replace four all-conference players, but will still try to bring the heat against the freshman Rosen, whose career begins with play action, looking over the top, showing off the arm, deep ball is dropped. Kenny Walker running behind the defense, and the kid put it on the money, second and 10.
Kenny Walker is the fastest player on this UCLA team. He had three catches last year, two of them were for touchdowns. They try to let Josh Rosen take all that excitement and bottle it into one throw, and unfortunately Walker wasn't able to come away with it.
Working quickly, right back on the ball for second down and 10, and here's Perkins getting shot down by Kelvin Rainey, who's making his first career start. And UCLA, having taken that shot on first down, now faces third and long.
And we talked about it in the pregame. Expect John Tenuta to bring some pressure as UCLA lines up in the no-huddle offense.
On third down, Rosen goes into the flats. And close to a first down with Trey Nicholson making the tackle on Nate Iese. He's just short. The punt team comes out.
And that's the gamble you take when you try to open up the game with one long deep shot. If it doesn't convert, it takes all the wind out of you, and all of a sudden you're dealing with a three and out and your quarterback's not in rhythm.
They send it away to Smoke Mizell, who calls off his blockers, make sure they get out of the way of that one, and it rolls to a stop at the 22-yard line. Matt Mangle opens his season with a 50-yard punt. Matt Johns back to the field when you come back. Fox College Football is presented by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Back inside the Rose Bowl on a beautiful Saturday afternoon. Temperature in the low 70s as these two teams open up the season, meeting for only the second time. You know, last year's game at Virginia was a 28-20 UCLA win. But three defensive touchdowns for the Bruins in a game where Virginia actually outgained UCLA.
Yeah, two interceptions returned for touchdowns and one fumble. And then all of a sudden, Matt Johns entered the game and really provided a spark in a two-minute drive right before half, leading him down for a touchdown. And then the second half, again, continued to move the football. Unfortunately, just a little bit too little too late. But now Matt Johns has a chance to get revenge.
He was a perfect 4-for-4 on that opening drive. Starts this drive with a handoff to Vince Croce, the team captain. Converted defensive lineman, now playing fullback. And in an era where you don't see fullbacks very often anymore, this guy's a key piece.
He's a huge piece to this offensive unit in the way he lead blocks and carries the football with the toughness that they want at UVA.
Virginia back at it quickly on the jet sweep to Taquan Mizell with a flag down. Back around the line of scrimmage. Mizell to the 35, but again, a flag in the Virginia backfield.
Personal foul, chop block, offense, number 50 and number 71. 15-yard penalty, correction, half the distance to the goal, replay second down.
As UVA tried to get to the edge, the offensive line there was able to kind of high-low one of the interior defensive linemen, causing the personal foul. That's a big no-no.
Yeah, and instead of a first down across the 30, it moves the ball back inside the Virginia 15. One of the Virginia players went low on an engaged player, bringing the flag out. So second and 17 for Virginia. Another flag.
Snap infraction on the center. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Time now for our first Lowe's Never Stop Improving game break. Jenny Taft.
Joe, thank you. Number 6 Auburn facing Louisville at the Georgia Dome. Off a Louisville interception, Jeremy Johnson keeps it. Goes in from 1 yard out. Tigers up 7-0 early in the first. Joe, Brady, back to you guys.
All right, heck of a matchup there on this opening Saturday of the college football season. A good one here in Pasadena. Here's Albert Reed. Across the 10 to get a few back. And that's actually Smoke Mizell with a carry. They'll play 4 running backs, and they like what they've got in that group.
Yeah, and they all bring different attributes to the running game at UVA. Smoke Mizell gets the nickname Smoke for his speed. And as you can see, Albert Reed, more of the bowling ball downhill runner. We'll see Daniel Hamm, number 22, in there as well throughout the day. And sometimes you'll see both of them in the backfield at the same time.
I know you hate the phrase reserve the right to punt, but on 3rd down and a mile here.
And you're going to get prevent coverage, meaning a lot of people back there defending the sticks.
He'll dump it off and reserve the right to punt. As Mizell takes it across the 20, but it's those penalties early in the possession that kill the drive.
And that's going to happen in your first game of the season. There's going to be some issues working on the road, working with, you know, really a lot of moving parts, in particular up front for the offensive line for UVA. You know, besides their center, Jackson Mateo, the rest have experience, but there's some moving parts, kind of musical chairs, as they're trying to figure out which combination of offensive linemen are best fit to run block and really protect Matt Johns.
It was Randall Goforth back ready to return this punt. High spiraling kick that drives him inside the 25. And Goforth makes a man miss. Up to the 44. It was a 55-yard punt with a 14-yard return for a guy that had a touchdown on defense last year. The Pac-12's leading rusher a season ago is Paul Perkins. He and the UCLA offense back to the field after this. Highly recruited, but has become one of the top running backs in the country. Led the Pac-12 a season ago. And tries to find room off the left side here. Penetration from that Virginia defense right away. Zach Bradshaw, Micah Kaiser, 2 of the brand new linebackers in this defense.
Yeah, the UVA defense has a lot of experience up front with their front 4 and their secondary, but not so much the linebacker position. But that doesn't mean these guys aren't talented and can't flow to the football. Micah Kaiser, number 53, will be all over the field today.
On 2nd and 12, Rosen goes to Perkins. Maurice Kennedy angles him out of bounds for a gain of 5 or so, and 3rd down and long again for UCLA.
And I'll be curious to see if defensive coordinator John Tenuta brings some sort of pressure here. He calls them automatics, meaning they're automatically called. He's bringing the pressure, and they check out of it if they have to.
They bring 6. It's a screen. Perfect play call for the defense that Tenuta had on. And Perkins is down to the 25. Rainey with a stop after 28 yards.
Well, it's a bit of a cat and mouse game in the first quarter between Noel Mazzoni and John Tenuta. And in that case, Mazzoni got the better of him, calling the screen versus an all-out pressure.
Play action. Underneath. Across the 20, Thomas Duarte. Yeah, let's go back to that previous play.
If you could draw up a perfect scenario versus a blitz, it would be to throw a screen, and in particular to Paul Perkins, as talented as he is coming out of the backfield.
Soso Jamabo, true freshman, gets his first career carry. Highly touted running back out of Plano, Texas. But he's shut down, and it's 3rd down and 5 for the Bruins.
I'll be curious to see if Noel Mazzoni now takes a shot to the end zone. One matchup in particular today to look at is number 7, Devin Fuller, versus cornerback Maurice Kennedy for UVA.
Down to the near side of the screen. Rosen looking away from it. Firing into the soft spot in the zone, and it's 1st down and goal as he finds Jordan Payton for 16.
Offensive coordinator Noel Mazzoni talked about the relationship between Rosen and Jordan Payton, and just their connection. In this case, he gets it to Thomas Duarte on the outs, on the sideline. And what they liked most about Rosen as a freshman was his ability to throw it in tight windows in zone coverage. He came in right away with a chip on his shoulder, knowing that he has a strong enough arm. to fit it in the tight holes that a lot of people don't think a true freshman can.
So as Duarte setting up first down and goal. Rosen into the end zone, touchdown UCLA. It's Devin Fuller to start the scoring in 2015.
Far right side of your screen, UCLA lines up in a stacked bunch. What happens is Maurice Kennedy, responsible for number seven, gets picked off by Jordan Payton running across the middle of the field. That opens up Devin Fuller for Josh Rosen's first touchdown as a collegiate quarterback.
But because there's no flag, it was actually a rub, right? Wasn't a pick?
I don't want to get into that.
Neuheisel pulls the snap down. And Fairbairn bangs it through. UCLA on a drive where Josh Rosen was a perfect 5 for 5. Cashes in. This was Perkins converting third down. Then they set up first and goal with Duarte. And underneath they went to Fuller. 7-3 UCLA. And by Dr. Pepper in college football, it's a one-of-a-kind tradition. 7-3 UCLA. Brady, take us inside that touchdown from Rosen.
Let's take a look at that first touchdown. Jordan Payton's going to run a little crossing route. Devin Fuller's going to kind of sit right here in the end zone, and coming across, the wide receiver for UCLA is going to run outside. Now, the two cornerbacks for Virginia are in and out in the coverage, but because of Jordan Payton's route, Maurice Kennedy cannot get through to get to Devin Fuller, hence the touchdown. Great offensive scheme and design by offensive coordinator Noel Mazzoni.
And the first career touchdown throw for Josh Rosen. Reed lets that one sail into the end zone. And Virginia back to work at the 25-yard line. Tonight, college football on Fox Sports 1 continues. Dak Prescott leading Mississippi State, coming off that 10-win season to take on Southern Miss. That's at 10 Eastern. And tomorrow, don't miss a special Sunday edition of college football on Fox Sports 1. It's Purdue and it's Marshall. It went 13-1 a season ago. Both those games also streamed live on Fox Sports Go. Well, Virginia marched down the field impressively on its opening drive and settled for a field goal. And then was hampered by penalties on drive two and had to punt.
One of the toughest things to overcome is penalties, turnovers, in particular when you're on the road. You've got to play a clean football game.
Play action on first down. Johns wants to take a shot towards the sideline, and it's incomplete. He got hit right as he let it go, and that forced an errant throw, second and 10.
And both these young quarterbacks are going to have to work through getting hit today, knowing it's coming, but still delivering an accurate football. Easy to say, tough to do. Believe me, I've been in those shoes before.
Four straight season, Virginia's had a break in a new starting quarterback. Grayson Lambert got beat out by Johns, transferred to Georgia. Johns on second and 10, gives it to Reed. Third and 8. Instability at the quarterback position. A big part of the story for Virginia during Mike London's tenure. Michael Rocco transferred to Richmond after going 3-5 as the starter. David Watford was the starter in 2013. He transferred to Hampton. And then we mentioned Grayson Lambert. He started 9 games last year off to Georgia, where he won the starting job.
And it seems like they just kind of have a quick hook on whatever quarterback has played. He throws an interception all of a sudden or two, and he's yanked. I mean, they really haven't stuck through a guy who's been able to battle through adversity. We'll see if Matt Johns can hopefully be that longtime starter for UVA.
Delay of the game, offense, 5 yards, third down.
Well, that experience is starting to show a little bit with Matt Johns. One thing UVA has got to be mindful of is outside linebacker Deion Hollins. That guy comes off the edge so fast, it almost looks like he's offsides.
Could be a great fit in Tom Bradley's system.
Yeah, number 58 is a blazer. I mean, you really do have to slow down the film to see. Jim Moore talked about it in practice all the time. They try to catch him, but he's too good. He's the returning leading sack guy for UCLA from last year.
On third long, they twist up front and get to Johns. It's fourth down. There's Deion Hollins. You mentioned it. First sack of the season.
Deion Hollins is going to come off the edge, and he's going to beat you with speed, but also how low he stays off the edge. He's 6'2", 6'3", 240, and he can run with the best of them. He's a special player. You're going to see him playing on Sundays.
Nicholas Conti back out there for his second punt. Drilled at 55 yards his first time. Goforth catches on the move and takes it into Virginia territory with a flag coming in late. There is a flag down.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 28. That's a spot foul, 10 yards, first down.
How about our Built Ford Tough keys to the game today, Brady?
For UVA, it's going to be getting pressure on the young Josh Rosen and getting some takeaways. That's always going to help you on the road. And for UCLA, feed the ball to Paul Perkins. That's going to take a lot of pressure off a young quarterback in Josh Rosen's shoes. That's going to help open up some of those deep play-action shots.
Well, you got to say Rosen's been pretty darn impressive through a couple drives. He's 6 for 7. The one incompletion was a drop touchdown on the game's first play. After the penalty, first down from the 41. Mossy Johnson swinging out. This will go down as a run, as it was a backwards pass, and he loses yards with a flag down on the far side.
Looks like an offsides on number 32, Mike Moore.
Offsides, number 32 defense, 5-yard penalty, replay first down.
And Mike Moore's a guy who's trying to fill in for, you know, heralded guys and Max Vallis and Eli Harold. They produced so much production, really rushing the passer last season, so he's really trying to make a name for himself and be an impact player for UVA.
First down and 5. Perkins gets met in the hole by Kelvin Rainey, making his first career start. Impressively filled that hole from his safety spot.
Yeah, the safeties are very active for UVA. Both Quinn Blanding and Kelvin Rainey will be coming down a lot to make tackles.
Rainey replaced one of the departed all-conference players. In fact, replaced an All-American in Anthony Harris on this Virginia defense. Second and 5 with the first quarter winding down. Rosen throws underneath. He's got a first down into Virginia territory. Mossy Johnson with his first catch of the season to bring this first quarter to a close. UCLA with a 7-3 advantage. High expectations again for the Bruins coming off a second straight 10-win season. Fox Sports College Football is presented by GEICO, and it's back after this. College football is presented by GEICO. I'm back at the Rose Bowl, ready to start quarter number 2 at UCLA in front 7-3. Josh Rosen back out there with the UCLA offense. 7 straight completions to 6 different receivers. That's vintage Coach Mazzoni.
That's exactly what he wants from his quarterback, distributing the football to all these talented guys on the outside.
Start the second quarter with a throw. He pumps him in the double move down the sideline. He misses Peyton, who had beaten Tim Harris, and it's second down.
Jordan Payton's the go-to guy up top for UCLA. He's going to run a little slant and go. They call that a sluggo. And Josh Rosen still has some of that excitement, still has some of those juices flowing right now. Just a little too much on that football. Don't be surprised if they don't come back again to another double move like that on the outside.
Perkins motions out on second down. They go back the other way, and it's shut down. Quinn Blanding makes the tackle on Mossy Johnson, the ACC's second leading tackler last year and the ACC Defensive Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, led all freshmen in the country in tackles, and he's very versatile. You know, he can cover like a cornerback, but he plays like a linebacker when he comes up and tackles. So, very versatile player. They'll put him in all sorts of different positions on the field.
Virginia shows edge pressure and backs off. And on third and long, Rosen, good feel in the pocket. A flag is down as he throws it close to the sticks to Tyler Scott. Flag down in the backfield. Let's see what it is.
Holding offense, number 68. 10-yard penalty, third down.
They're going to push them back a little bit just to try to take advantage of the field position battle. That was something that head coach Mike London really thought was a big factor. Josh Rosen's able to escape through the pocket. You know, going back, watching some of his high school film, he's more of a prototypical pocket passer, but he's got some athletic ability. I mean, he can move and scoot through the pocket a little bit.
They're down in a quarter of the field. One-on-one to the near side with Devin Fuller, who crosses the field and takes the throw. And you get a small chunk of it back into Virginia territory. Fourth down. Time for a game break. Time to say happy birthday, Jenny Taft.
Joe, thank you so much. BYU visiting Nebraska. How about Taysom Hill back after that horrible leg injury last year, taking it in for the touchdown, caps a 99-yard drive. We're tied up at 7 in Mike Riley's Nebraska debut. Joe, back to you.
All right, they brought heat on this punt, Jenny, and barely got it away. It falls inside the 10. And bounces right through one of the coverage men, finally downed at the 14-yard line. The 36-yard punt. Virginia back out there down 7-3 in the Rose Bowl on a beautiful Saturday to start the college football season. We're back to Pasadena after this break. And the last time Virginia won a road game.
Yeah, and actually they've been outscored last season, 83-46 in the first quarter of games, and that never helps. When you're on the road, you want to get off to a fast start, and they're already trailing here. 3-7.
13-20 left in this first half, and Matt Johns back out there. Here's Mizell up to the 18-yard line. And Miles Jack over to make the stop. There is a flag down.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle on the defense. 15 yards from the end of the play, first down.
Under Jim Mora, UCLA has been the most penalized major conference team in the country. This is their first today.
Yeah, but with that has come a lot of success. I'm not exactly sure if that was on Miles Jack or... Yeah, it looks like it was on Miles Jack. And he's got a little bit of a nastiness in him. You know, getting fights in training camp, but... I think they kind of like that. He's a guy with some edge, and he brings a lot of aggressiveness to this UCLA defense.
Need a guy like
play.
That.
You
huh?
Got to have a guy like that.
Play action for Johns, who's protected well. It has time to find Evan Butts. The redshirt freshman's first career catch comes at the Rose Bowl for 29 yards into Bruin territory.
The tight ends aren't a huge part of UVA's offense, but Evan Butts is able to get across the middle, do the play-action pass. That seems to open up many things.
Virginia was so impressive on that opening drive, but the last two possessions didn't do much. Showing something here early in the second quarter, down 7-3. Croce leading the way for Mizell, but Eddie Vanderdoes shed the block and dropped him for a gain of 2.
Vanderdoes is so quick up front. I mean, these guys, for how big they are, have great hands. They play with great leverage. And they do a good job of, on the initial contact, locking out that offensive lineman, shedding and getting to the ball carrier.
Open for big improvements from this Virginia offense this year, but a big test, like you mentioned, for that O-line against the talented interior of the UCLA defense. They fake it to Reed. John's under pressure. Smartly throws it away. And that'll bring up third down and 8.
The early story in this game has been the defensive line for UCLA, getting penetration in the run game, tracking down Matt Johns in the passing game for some sacks. They're a talented bunch, very experienced. And they've really taken to new defensive coordinator Tom Bradley's scheme. They're excited for the opportunity to be able to get after the quarterback more and put offenses more on the toes. Let's see if they bring pressure here on this 3rd and 8.
Cavaliers just 1 for 4 on 3rd down so far. Johns just gets rid of it in time into a crowded area downfield that brings in a flag. Kaden Severin was surrounded by 3 Bruins. One of them took him down. And that will likely extend this drive.
Pass interference, number 10 defense, first down.
Fabian Moreau.
Fabian Moreau was giving Cannon Severn a bit of a piggyback once he tried to go back upfield. See him grabbing onto the back of his jersey, and it's a little bit too obvious. They're probably going to call that the majority of the time. Moreau's a good cover corner. I mean, he's got good size, good hands, good speed. I mean, they really feel confident in Rios and Moreau on the outside being able to lock down most teams' wide receivers. As you see, Matt Johns now out of the backfield at wide receiver at the top of the screen here.
And they bring Mizell in motion, and Albert Reed off with the direct snap, crosses the 20. Second time they've gone to that formation. This one gains them 3, second and 7.
And at this point, UVA is just looking for any sort of different type of gimmick or scheme they can use to utilize against this very talented UCLA defense. The Wildcat a lot of times is an opportunity just to be able to get a particular defense you're facing against and get the blocking that you want up front to get a nice game.
Timeout, Virginia, their first timeout of the half.
Infinity, luxury cars that deliver inspired performance. Back in Pasadena, midway through the second quarter. Season opener between Virginia and UCLA. And it's the start of a really difficult schedule for Virginia. They're the only team in the country that in the month of September will play 3 ranked teams.
Got to go play against a talented Notre Dame team on September 12th. It's top 23, the 23rd ranked team in the country. The 25th versus Boise State with their big win over Washington last night.
Out of the timeout on second down. Here's Albert Reed. Cut down by Randall Goforth. And it'll be third down and short from about the 15-yard line. One of the big problems for Virginia's offense last year was cashing in with touchdowns once they got inside the 20.
That's one of those hidden stats in any football game is your conversion rate of touchdowns, not just scoring in the red zone. A lot of times everyone scores in the red zone. They have a high percentage, but it's the amount of times you come away with 7 points versus 3. That 4-point difference can a lot of times be the difference between winning and losing.
Yeah, they converted red zone trips into touchdowns less than half the time last year. Third down and short. Reed gets pulled down by Miles Jack. Fourth down and 2 coming up for Virginia.
Well, UCLA defense was showing a pressure look up front. Matt Johns looked like he checked the play, or maybe he just stuck with it. But either way, that's not probably the call you want to go to versus an all-out blitz like that. You'd rather try to protect yourself up and get a pass. See Miles Jack coming up around the line of scrimmage and able to make the tackle.
So Ian Fry back out there for his second field goal attempt. He's 2 for 2 today and has made 23 in a row from inside of 45 yards. So Fry's field goal brings Matt Johns in Virginia within 1. It's 7-6. And a beautiful day in Pasadena to launch the college football season. Virginia has to settle for another field goal, and it's 7-6. Midway through this second quarter, Joe Davis, Brady Quinn, Chris Budden back in Pasadena. And Devin Fuller back to return this kick from Dylan Sims. Well done into the corner of the end zone. And UCLA to start at the 25-yard line. Let's check in with Chris Budden.
Joe, UCLA running backs coach Kenny Polamalu having to do double duty today, coaching his running backs and the offensive line. That's because UCLA's O-line coach Adrian Clem is suspended for this game and next game. They're self-imposed sanctions due to some NCAA violations. So to make things more productive for Polamalu, he's had the offensive line and the running backs sitting together giving his message all at one time.
All right, Chris, and he'll watch the offense start from the 25. That O-line protecting the true freshman Rosen, who got rid of it against the blitz to Perkins out of the backfield, cut down by Kelvin Rainey, and it's second down. How big of a deal is that, not having your O-line coach there on game day?
Well, it can be a huge deal, in particular going up against a defense like UVA, who likes to mix up their fronts, and a lot of the communication that goes on an offensive line in between series is usually with their offensive line coach. So it's a big loss for UCLA.
Trying to take advantage of the numbers to the short side of the field. Aaron Andrews with his first reception, and Micah Kaiser quickly over to set up third down.
UCLA offense is picking up the tempo a bit and trying to stay within third and manageable, helping out the young Rosen. Now that we've got a quarter under our belt, I'll look to see if John Tenuta brings a little bit more pressure.
David Dean got a great jump off of the ball, thrown into a tight window, and pass interference going to get caught on Tim Harris.
Pass interference, number 5, defense, spot foul, first down.
Tim Harris has had a lot of experience, having to play a little bit maybe earlier than he was ready to play as a cornerback. Got thrusted in once the injury occurred to Trey Nicholson a season ago, and he's since continued to grow and develop and get better. It's a little bit too soon on that last play, trying to break up the pass.
Perkins straight ahead. And that's Andrew Brown, the former Gatorade National High School Player of the Year, that helped plug the hole and get his first tackle, along with Kaiser. And second down coming up.
It's a shot of defensive coordinator John Tenuta. Many years throughout college football at Ohio State, Notre Dame, Georgia Tech. Been a lot of places. Been very effective.
Perkins with room. Or a first down. I know you had to play. He was at Notre Dame after you, but you played against him while you were at ND.
Yeah, when he was at Georgia Tech. And look, he's a guy who, I mentioned it earlier, he has what's called an automatic, meaning he's going to bring pressure, and then the defense will check out of it if they don't like what they see.
Perkins with a seam, and Paul Perkins gets tripped up by Rainey, who makes a touchdown-saving tackle. But not before 18 yards for the junior.
Well, one of the keys when you bring pressure and put a bunch of guys up around the line of scrimmage is maintaining your gap, integrity, and right there, 32, Mike Moore did not come down the line tight enough to not allow a seam for Paul Perkins.
Rosen off of the double move, down the seam, perfectly thrown, touchdown, UCLA. It's Duarte.
Quinn Blanding is going to be playing Thomas Duarte one-on-one up the seam. Rosen throws just a perfect ball. There's no better way of defending that. Duarte is able to come down with it. Duarte and Rosen have really built a connection over the course of training camp and off-season workouts together.
Yeah, we asked Jim Mora who is maybe one guy flying under the radar that he thought would play a role in this game. He was quick to point to Thomas Duarte. Great size, 6'3", 225, and needed that extension to get to a perfectly thrown ball from Josh Rosen, who's got his second career touchdown here in the second quarter, and a 14-6 UCLA lead. Fox College Football is sponsored by State Farm. Bump up your savings with a discount double check today. By DraftKings, free one-week fantasy football at DraftKings.com. And by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you've got to get DirecTV. Josh Rosen, efficient once again, 7 plays, 75 yards, and it lasted just over 2 minutes as he found Duarte for the score. Izell back to receive this Fairbairn kick. Way out of the back of the end zone as we go back to the touchdown.
We're going to check out safeties Kelvin Rainey and Quinn Blanding. Blanding is going to be one-on-one on Thomas Duarte up the seam. Kelvin Rainey needs to get back to the deep middle of the field and do a better job of helping out Quinn Blanding. He's just able to run vertically up there, and he's got no help from his safety. Never the coverage you'd like to see out of your defense. I'm sure defensive coordinator John Tenuta is communicating that down to the sidelines. Now we'll see if UVA and Matt Johns can respond, similar to what they had to endure a year ago.
Mm-hmm. They fell behind 21-3 with the three defensive touchdowns by UCLA. Johns helped them come back and make it close. Izell can't get outside. It was Kenny Young, who Jim Mora thinks is the prototypical middle linebacker for this defense.
Yeah, very vocal, very physical player. Really the quarterback of their defense. Does a nice job of getting everyone lined up and taking on some of those lead blockers like Vincent Croce, a guy who's 6'4", 260. Not an easy job, but they love the way Kenny Young plays.
6'4", 260 against 6'1", 235. Sophomore out of New Orleans. On second down. Johns on a half roll. Gets outside and slings it to the sideline on the money for a first down. Caden Severin got loose. And Johns put it on the spot.
What a play. Rolling out in the boot, a little bit of a misdirection, and Caden Severin's going to run a deep comeback. Matt Johns bought just enough time with his legs to be able to hold off and make the accurate throw on the run. Watch Caden Severin run this deep 20-yard comeback. You got to have a hose to do it, and on the run it makes it a little bit easier, but not so much.
A straight drop on first down, and room over the middle for Mizell, and smoke Mizell as a gain of 18 into UCLA territory. They were excited to see what he would do in his first opportunity to be the featured guy, and he's been impressive so far.
Yeah, and that's what's so impressive about him is really his route running ability. Usually running backs don't run with quite the precision that you'd like to see, like in a wide receiver, but Smoke Mizell is one of those guys who really takes his time to run, be patient with his route, get in and out of his cuts, and feel those zone coverages. Sometimes fast guys like that have a hard time feeling the zone coverage, but Smoke Mizell has a feel for the game.
Dots the eye on first down and 10. Croce leads the way for him, but he can't spin away. Blue shirts around him. No gain. Time for a game break. Jenny Taft.
Joe, thanks. Portland State, Washington State, and Pullman. The Cougars trailing the Vikings in the fourth until this. Luke Falk to Gabe marks this game not over yet. The Cougars tie it up at 17. Joe Brady, back to you guys.
Wow, so the FCS ranks making it tough on Washington State week one.
A lot of parity in college football, not just in the FBS and the FCS. I mean, more and more teams are getting more and more talented, and coaches across the country are getting better and better at being competitive.
Yeah, and it looks like Mike London got a timeout.
Timeout.
It's his second
Virginia.
Of this opening
half.
Time
out of the half.
Back in a moment.
30-second timeout.
Here's our KFC stat comparison. Matt Johns, his fourth career start. Josh Rosen, his first. Both efficient, but you think that Matt Johns and Virginia need to take a few shots downfield to loosen that box.
Yeah, the UCLA defense is really starting to crowd around the line of scrimmage, putting an extra guy in the box to stop the run. And at some point, UVA has got to take some shots downfield, try to soften up UCLA's cornerbacks and really their secondary.
Virginia averaging only around 2 yards per carry right now. And a flag flies in. It's going to be on Virginia.
False start. Offense number 86. 5 yards. Second down.
It's a tight end, Charlie Hopkins. Stanford transfer. I see Stanford lost to Northwestern today.
Yeah. Not what you want to see out of the Pac-12 right now, and in particular Pac-12 North. But maybe that makes a better case for Oregon trying to get to the Pac-12 championship game. A lot of high hopes for Stanford and quarterback Kevin Hogan returning. He's been so productive over the course of his career, but not what you want to see coming into his final year of eligibility.
Second and 16 here for Virginia. Penalties have been a bit of a problem for him in this opening half. Six of them for 42 yards. They get back the penalty yards with Mizell. Continues to show signs of why he was so highly touted coming out of high school.
Yeah, a lot of speed, a lot of cutting ability. You know, at some point it just clicked for him. As far as his ability to run more downhill, not try to shake and bake at the line of scrimmage and waste a lot of footwork. So Smoke Mizell's a player coming off the field now, but has had a huge impact so far in this game, and it's been awesome to see his continued growth and improvement.
Third down and long again for Virginia. It's a screen. And Miles Jack for the second time is called for a horse collar. Pulling down Alameda Zacchaeus. True freshman with his first touch.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle, number 30 defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Second time Jack has been called for that. And that extends his drive.
Miles Jack very active in the UCLA defense, running all over the field at that weak linebacker position. Tom Bradley's had so many athletic and productive linebackers over the course of his career, being at Penn State for 30 years as a longtime assistant. Miles Jack is another one that we'll be able to hang his cap on, but not the type of way you want to bring down a ball carrier.
Crowd didn't like it, but if it wasn't a horse collar, it was a face mask.
Yeah.
So from the 24. Vanderdoes waiting for Mizell on a short gain. Junior from Auburn, California, 47 in blue. He's been a starter all three seasons, part of this really good defensive line.
Yeah, and look, again, he's one of those guys who's able to take up a lot of the offensive linemen to free up linebackers, Kenny Young and Miles Jack. When UVA talks about that power running game, what that means is they're going to be pulling a lot of guards. You're going to see Jack McDonald, Ross Burbank, again, trying to climb up the second level on the linebackers. And Eddie Vanderdoes, the UCLA defensive front, have been very effective in not allowing those guys to do their job.
Johns gets it into the flats against the blitz, and Mizell trying to run away from Young. You got a block at the last moment from Keon Johnson to get him an extra yard or two. We'll see where they spot him. Looks like just short.
I think if you asked Mike London about Matt Johns' production at this point in the game, if he was 9 of 11 for 100, excuse me, 10 of 12 for 124 yards, I think he'd be pretty pleased. I mean, they're hanging in this game. They've been moving the ball pretty effectively. That doubled the amount of time of possession. Besides the penalties, you know, really they've done a good job offensively running the football and staying within third and short.
They go out of the gun on third down and one. Johns looks to throw, and they throw the stop for a first down. It was Kanan Severin, and he's living up to his reputation so far, which is the guy you go to in situations like that.
Yeah, Kanan Severin has some one-on-one coverage up top. Matt Johns puts it right in a spot where Kanan Severin's able to secure the football, get the first down, and you'll see UVA is going with a lot more two tight end sets and multiple fullback or running back sets because they're getting more one-on-one coverage on the outside. It's an easier read and easier play for Matt Johns to convert on third down.
He took advantage of the soft coverage to put the ball at the 10-yard line. John sets his feet and throws into the flats off of the fingertips of the tight end Evan Butts. Second and goal.
Evan Butts been pretty active so far, considering UVA just from a year ago, offensive coordinator Steve Fairchild really didn't involve the tight ends too much in the passing game, but you know, with them trying to run the football, in particular the power running game more, now it makes more sense to try to get those tight ends and fullbacks, quick hitters out to the flat. It's tough to defend when they're used to coming up and bashing in on linebackers a lot of the time.
12th play of this drive, second down and goal. Virginia trying to cash in with a touchdown. Reed surges up to the 6. Vanderdoes again in there on the stop. And once again, Brady, here's Virginia moving the ball, but can they capitalize with a touchdown?
Well, it's going to come down to Matt Johns and his ability to be effective. He may have to make a move with his feet if UCLA tends to play coverage. And if not, they're going to be bringing pressure. And then he's got to be accurate and effective on time with the football.
Timeout called, UCLA.
It'll be third down and goal back in 30 seconds. All right, so third down and goal for Virginia. What are you going to here to try and crack that goal up?
Well, you got to find a way of spreading out the UCLA defense. You know, we've seen UVA incorporate some multiple wide receiver sets and then spread out a little bit. But in this particular drive, they've tried to play with more tight ends and fullbacks and try to get some more one-on-one coverage on the outside in order to better protect Johns and try to get those key one-on-one matchups.
Again, last year, this was a big issue. They converted red zone trips into touchdowns less than half the time.
Don't be surprised if they didn't find Kanan Severin again.
He was the man in motion. Johns looking his way and hit him at the 2. He's thrown out of bounds by Marcus Rios. It's fourth down and goal from the one. They do spot him, looks like, at the two-yard line, but decision time either way.
And it looks like head coach Mike London's deciding to kick.
Take the points on the road?
Yeah, I think this early in the game, you know, I mean, coming off of three losing seasons now, I think Mike London, you know, may feel some pressure sometimes to make an overly aggressive decision, but he chooses to take the points here. Probably a smart play.
Fry, the former walk-on, who's turning into automatic. 3-for-3 today, and Virginia has to settle again for a field goal. It's 14-9, closing minutes of the first half in Pasadena. For that Georgia squad, the Virginia transfer. Speaking of quarterbacks, Josh Rosen, what have been your thoughts on him so far?
He's been incredibly efficient. He's been accurate. Really, besides missing one deep ball, overthrowing it, he's been dead on the money. I mean, as advertised, the chosen Rosen, they call him, has been every bit of what his five-star rating would be.
12-for-14 so far. One of those incompletions was a perfect throw that was dropped. That one's kicked out of bounds, and with a minute 37 here, we'll give UCLA excellent field position.
Free kick out of bounds. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
Let's get a game break now with Jenny Taft.
Well, Joe, getting you caught up in Pullman, could another Pac-12 team get upset today as Stephen Long puts Portland State back up 24-17, capping off a 14-play drive? Mike Leach's Cougars in trouble. Joe, back to you.
All right, Jenny, but if there's any offense that can move quickly, it'd be his. We'll see if they can do it in the final minutes against Portland State. Rosen well protected, throwing down the sideline, and it's caught. It was Perkins running by Zach Bradshaw for a gain of 26.
Yeah, Paul Perkins is going to run a wheel route out of the backfield. Just matched up one-on-one with 51 Zach Bradshaw. And Paul Perkins has the athletic and speed advantage in that one.
It's a screen. Perkins gets drilled by David Dean, who shed the block. The captain of the defense drops him for a loss.
Yeah, really an experienced, two-year letter winner in David Dean. Those experienced guys up front tend to recognize their screens a little bit quicker.
UCLA working quickly with two timeouts inside of a minute. Rosen with all day to throw. The coverage downfield leads to the pressure, and he goes down. Had a nice pocket, but great Virginia coverage led that pocket to collapse. Trent Corney will get credit.
Defensive coordinator Johnson Newton is laying off some of the pressure looks and instead being to play more coverage and allowing his front four to try to get pressure on the young QB.
They did here. David Dean with a bit of a bull rush. Corney came off of the edge and got to him. Make sure you stick around for the State Farm halftime report. Just around the corner. 44 ticks left in this opening half at the Rose Bowl. UCLA with a 14-9 advantage behind two Josh Rosen touchdown throws. But looking at a third down and 14 after the sack. Virginia brings some delayed pressure. Rosen, good patience in the pocket. And threw a strike to the sideline for Eldridge Massington and a first down against Trey Nicholson.
And that's one of the tests you want to see out of a young quarterback coming out of high school. Can he throw the out route from the opposite hash? And Josh Rosen has a strong enough arm to do it. Right there, converting on the third down and keeping the drive alive.
Rosen floating it once. Perkins, who pulled it in but was out of bounds. With the coverage from Zach Bradshaw, second and 10.
You fool me once, but not fool me twice for Zach Bradshaw. Same play, just flipped on the other side of the field. Paul Perkins is going to free release into the flat and run up the wheel, but Zach Bradshaw, smart play. They got smart players there at UVA. It's a tough school to get into. You recognized it. Nice play. But how accurate is Rosen?
My goodness.
That ball was right on the money again.
And how calm in the pocket. Part of that is credit to this veteran offensive line who's given him all day. Again, time to scan the field, deliver a strike. Inside the 15, it's Massington against Harris for a first down.
He's utilizing that matchup of Tim Harris versus Eldridge Massington. And Tim Harris has struggled a bit in the past, in particular in one-on-one coverage.
Massington beat him on the game's first play last year for a 48-yard completion. First down from the 12, Rosen floating, corner of the end zone, incomplete. Wanted Duarte again, who's already got one touchdown catch today. Pressure from Andrew Brown, second down.
And Andrew Brown's going to hit Josh Rosen right at the end of this play, right as he releases the football. And that's what John Tenuta wants to see, is if Josh Rosen can hang in there and deliver an accurate football. It's hard to throw it any better than that. I mean, this kid is just lights out.
16 of 20 in his debut half. Four-man rush picked up. Takes what they give him for 5 yards. Jordan Payton, and the final timeout is used by the Bruins with 11 seconds.
Plenty of time here, too. You got a timeout left. 11 seconds, you can really throw the ball anywhere inside the field here and throw short of the goal line and still let them run in. So really your whole playbook here in the red zone still intact. You don't have to force one into the red zone.
Sure is an interesting case here, Brady, with UCLA, who's got so much experience, but then the most important position on the field, a true freshman. But when you add in a guy who's playing like this, I mean, this is a sign of things to come. This UCLA team, scary moving forward.
Yeah, from talking to the coaching staff, I mean, they saw Rosen takes his ups and downs throughout the course of training camp. They just felt like when you see these flashes of his ability in those team periods and in seven-on-sevens, you watch him throw the football. I mean, you can tell this kid's going to be a big-time player, and you might as well put him in now, or he's got all his talent out around him, and see if maybe he can mold into, you know, a star early on in his career.
Third down and 6. Trying to extend the lead to 2 scores before the break. Rosen to the back of the end zone. Too tall, and it's fourth down.
And Trent Corney in there, getting in Rosen's face, not really allowing him to set his feet and deliver a more accurate football. Just a bit high. Again, Corney coming in there at the end. You can just see this kid, the determination on his face, wanting just to be so perfect. Kind of comes from that tennis background he used to have when he was a young kid.
Drew Brees, another tennis guy, turned into a quarterback. Kyanny Fairbairn's field goal is good. It makes it a 17-9 advantage. And a couple of ticks still left. This opening half, Jim Mora has turn this program into a power, really on the verge of being one of the powers across the college football landscape. Year before they got here, they went 6-8. Coach Neuheisel's final season, went to the Pac-12 championship game because SC was on a postseason ban. Mora came before 2012, went 9-5, and a 10-win season in 2013. They won 10 games again last year for the first top 10 finish for the Bruins since 1998. Under Jim Mora, for the first time in program history, 3 consecutive seasons of at least 9 wins. Expectations again big coming into this year.
And they should be. And something that's not mentioned there is just his job recruiting. I mean, he's had top recruiting class after top recruiting class, and you've got to have talent to be able to coach him. And he's able to do both those things. So Jim Mora, a big part of all the success they've had, as well as obviously the talent he's able to bring in as these kids continue to develop. I mean, they're a very experienced team, but they still are pretty young.
Yeah, not many seniors across that 2D. That one goes out of the back of the end zone. And they'll have to run one play to finish off this first half. Now, Virginia, despite 3 trips deep into UCLA territory, only 9 points to show for it, but at the same time, glass half full, they're within a touchdown.
Yeah, you're only down 1 score, and again, I think if you go back and ask Mike London before the game, how would you feel about being only down 1 score after the first half, he'd probably take it.
Yeah.
Considering the talent of this UCLA team, the success they had last season, starting an inexperienced quarterback in Matt Johns. I mean, last year at this point, I mean, they were fighting and scrapping and clawing just to get back into that game. So in a much better position to try to hold off UCLA and make a run in the second half.
8-point game as the teams head to the locker rooms. We go down to Chris Butt.
Thanks so much, Joe. Coach, what have you thought of Matt Johns' performance in that first half?
Well, I tell you what, he's been moving the team pretty good here. We got to get touchdowns, we get opportunity, but We got to stop on defense now. That quarterback, to get the ball, is getting it out quick. We got to get to him, do something with the throwing lanes. But they're protecting a young guy like that and making throws, making plays. But our offense can move the ball on him.
You talked about moving the ball. What do you guys need to do to find more efficiency in the red zone?
Well, just make sure we get down there. We saw one play that Cannon had reach over us a touchdown. The difference between penalties that gets you backed up. So, you know, we just got to settle down and keep playing football. You're on the road, keep playing the brand of football that can keep you in games if you play hard, play smart.
Appreciate it. Good luck in the second half, Coach. Joe?
All right, Chris. We started the game by talking about new quarterbacks, both efficient, right around 70% combined. Right now, we get you to Rob Stone across Los Angeles. Bruins in front 17-9 as we welcome you back inside to get you ready for the second half with Brady Quinn. Joe Davis, we came into this game talking about, Brady, how we figured Virginia would need to be able to run the football to have a good shot, only averaging about 2 yards per carry, but within eight.
Yeah, and it's really because of the interior defensive lineman for UCLA. When you talk about Kenny Clark, he's the leading tackler right now. Eddie Vanderdoes, he's second. He's got two tackles for loss. So they're getting the penetration that they need. And then Miles Jack, the weak side linebacker, he's come in to fill and make those plays. And you look at UVA and their ability not to convert in the red zone right now, it's because they're not running the football quite as well.
How about on the other side, Josh Rosen has advertised through a half, huh?
You know, we talked about Paul Perkins getting the football out in the running game. It's really the passing game. He's the leading wide receiver right now with 58 yards on five catches. But Josh Rosen's been outstanding, accurate, slinging the ball all over the field, making the right decisions. Really, both these quarterbacks have played a pretty clean half. No turnovers, taking care of the football, and that's why we've got a one-score game right now.
Virginia dominated the time of possession in that first half. More than 20 of the 30 minutes, the Cavaliers had the football. So with a touchback, UCLA will start at the 25. Chris Budden talked to their head coach.
Well, and as you guys said, he was obviously very pleased with Josh Rosen. But what he's liked most about him is his poise and his calmness in this environment and being able to handle UVA's pressure that they're bringing on defense. For the Bruins defense, he's happy with that as well, being able to keep them out of the end zone. He said the key, though, to the second half is they have to contain Matt Johns. One other note, Joe, Nate Starks, the running back, will not play during this game. In fact, he's not even dressed out. He's watching the game in the stands. UCLA would not tell me why he's absent today.
All right, Chris, so that's why we've seen almost all Paul Perkins. So-so Jamambo, the only other running back to see the field so far. Rosen begins the second half with a strong arm throw to Devin Fuller, close to the sticks, working against Trey Nicholson. Fuller's third catch of the day begins his half.
He just plays so wise beyond his years right now. Josh Rosen gets the snap, drops back, steps up, avoids pressure, and throws an accurate ball right on the money.
On second down and one, Perkins goes for a first down, averaging about 5 yards per carry so far behind that offensive line, the most experienced in the country.
Yeah, and that plays a big part, but it's also the balance. I mean, when you're throwing the football this effectively, it helps open up the running game as well.
From the 45, quickly outside of the speedy Fuller, who made a couple of men miss and turned what would have been a loss into a gain of three.
One of the keys talking to defensive coordinator Johnson Udo was tackling in space. He said UCLA does a nice job of spreading the field, so it comes down to us being able to wrap up and make those tackles on these quick screens at the line of scrimmage, not allowing them to get a four-yard gain like we saw just right there.
Goes into throw again, into pressure over the head of Perkins as Bradshaw came bearing down on him. It's a big play early in this second half for the Virginia defense with third and seven.
Yeah, they've got to come up with a stop and try to find a way to get the ball back and continue to drive the ball down the field. I mean, their offenses move the ball for UVA. They just have not converted in the red zone. But, again, their defense is going to have to try to choose if they want to try to pressure Rosen and leave themselves vulnerable on the outside with one-on-one coverage or play more coverage and see if they can eventually get to him.
Show pressure here and bring it. Jamambo swings out of the backfield. Rosen sails it over his head. Mike Moore, the defensive end, was in pursuit and coverage of the tailback. And Virginia does force that punt to begin the second half.
Yeah, really good coverage by the UVA secondary and really their outside DN, Mike Moore, able to couple Paul Perkins on that little bit of a swing pass. So good job getting off the field.
Whistle blows this one dead.
False start, number four offense, 5 yards, fourth down.
So Matt Mangle got a little bit of a warm-up. We'll send it away again. for Jim Mora's squad. Coming off their first top 10 finish since 1998, winning 10 games last year for the second season in a row. The high expectations again as Mangle steps into it again. Izell signals for the fair catch on a short punt that is downed at the 29-yard line. Matt Johns, who was impressive during that first half, takes the offense back to the field, down one score on the opening Saturday of the college football season at the Rose Bowl in Pasadena. Colonel Sanders' Kentucky Fried Chicken. It's still finger-licking good. Yeah, by the all-new 2015 Jeep Renegade. And by the U.S. Army. As you look at the Griffith Observatory here in Los Angeles, not too far from iconic Blue Jam Cafe where you hammered some French toast the other day.
Absolutely delicious.
Matt Johns, his first possession of half number two after an impressive first half. His team down by a touchdown. And from the 29, they start with a handoff to Smoke Mizell, and again, it's blown up. It was Deion Hollins off of the edge. We started the game by talking about how Virginia would need to be able to run the football. They've not been able to.
No, they have not been able to. And one of the places you'd think they'd be weak is on the edge. You got Tack McKinley, who's only 6'2", 250. Deion Hollins, he's sitting there at 6'2", about 240. Two undersized guys, you figure the power running game would be where you want to direct it. But look, their speed has actually overcome that, and they've been able to get back, get into the backfield and make some tackles for a loss.
Keep it on the ground. Mizell gets two. It'll be interesting to see Steve Fairchild, offensive coordinator for Virginia, how long he sticks with trying to run the football. He thought he got away from it at times last year.
Yeah, and that's one of the things I think I appreciate about offensive coordinator Steve Fairchild is he does a nice job of maintaining the stick with the run. He doesn't give up on it too early and put too much on Matt Johns' shoulders. But at some point here in the second half, we're going to have to open it up and allow Matt Johns to have the ability to take some more shots downfield.
Seems like a predictable spot for one here on third and nine. Johns will dump it off. Mizell gets pulled down from behind. Big play by Kenny Young. And that will force the punt. Boy, if Young doesn't make that tackle, it's a first down.
Nah, he had a ton of running room out in front of Smoke Mizell, but Kenny Young able to shed the tight end, Evan Butts, fight through it and get to Smoke Mizell for the first down saving tackle. Huge play by Kenny Young.
Devin Fuller goes back for this punt from Nicholas Conti, who averaged close to 50 yards a pop in the first half. And Fuller gets thrown down. Excellent work on special teams. Now it's Wilfred Wahi with a tackle. And UCLA will have the ball again on the other side of this break. The debut game for Josh Rosen, the chosen one. Impressive through two plus quarters. But the marching band in town providing the atmosphere for this season opener. Josh Rosen and the offense back to work with a 17-9 lead. Their second possession of this second half. Outside they go to Paul Perkins, who fights hard for a few yards, and it'll be second down. Now, John Tenuta, we've talked about, has a personality of a guy who's going to bring pressure. But Josh Rosen, the ability to get rid of the ball quickly and beat him when he does bring pressure, is putting him in a tough spot.
It has, because he doesn't have the personnel just to be able to rush four guys and be able to get home to the quarterback. So he's got to bring an extra guy, which makes them weak in their pass coverage. So it's pick your poison against this very talented UCLA wide receiver core, really skilled player unit.
Perkins falls forward and sets up third down and two. Wilfred Wahi, Quani Moore combining in the tackle. And Virginia with another chance to force a punt early on in this second half. Rosen has a wide open man. First down and then some. Into Virginia territory goes Nate Iesse on his second catch of the afternoon.
Nate Iese is going to release downfield on a corner route. A little misdirection in the backfield. Gets all the UVA defenders looking at the run action. All of a sudden, Nate Iese, not a big wide receiver, making a big play there.
Perkins running hard and running through a defender for close to a first down.
Paul Perkins' show is starting to take over now. Getting a little more carries in the run game. Been extremely effective as a receiver out of the backfield. 5 catches, 58 yards. Now he's got 52 in the running game as well.
Back to him again. Slipped the tackle to David Dean. Fell forward for two. I was a little surprised in the first half that they were as pass heavy as they were. About 2-1 pass to run.
But I think that's the cat and mouse game. Noel Mazzoni, the offensive coordinator for UCLA. Defensive coordinator Johnson Newt are playing. I mean, they've gone back way deep. Back to the ACC days, playing against one another. They know each other well. And most people would expect them to run first, and instead they open up passing the football more.
Here's Fuller getting a block and a first down. Wahi with a tackle after a pickup of 11.
And Fuller's really the wide receiver that UCLA likes to move around in motion and really put him in the slot, outside, in the backfield. He does all sorts of things for this Bruin offense. You see why. He's very capable once he gets in the open field of getting some yards upfield and hurting.
Timeout, Virginia. Their first timeout of the half.
Virginia will use a timeout. 9.5 left in this third quarter.
And as you go back and look at the previous play, Fuller comes back in motion like he's going to come back around the backfield, but then releases back on the slot. What that does is allows him to get leverage or an extra step on Wilfred Wahi. That's all he needs to be able to get upfield and get a first down.
Well, it's Tuesday, Brady. The one and only Colin Cowherd makes his debut on FS1. The most unique voice in sports. Back on the air, The Herd with Colin Cowherd. Premieres Tuesday at noon Eastern, only on FS1. Streaming live on Fox Sports Go. Smart sports talk, finally.
Talking about a guy with an opinion.
Yeah.
Colin Cowherd's got an opinion about anything and everything. I think he's changed something to his hair. His hair looked a little more Cali style, maybe.
Cali style, yeah.
Whatever
he's transitioned out here. On first down, Perkins into the short side. And Calvin Rainey's had a good start to his first career start in that safety spot.
Yeah, I mean, they liked how active he is coming up to stop the run. As UCLA, with an 8-point lead or a 1-touchdown lead, they're going to want to continue to get the running game going.
On second down, they bring pressure. It's picked up. So Rosen with time to find his man inside the 10. Fuller again, who's had a good start to the second half.
What I liked most about that play was Josh Rosen was patient. There was a bunch formation. They ran a three-man route combination. There's some picks involved, and it took a moment for the wide receiver to get open, but Rosen was patient enough, and really the offensive line provided him enough time. I mean, you got to take your hat off to those big boys out front. They're doing a nice job protecting Rosen.
They bring on Eddie Vanderdoes to lead the way for a Perkins run that sets up first down and goal. Why not go to that defensive line and bring a 6'3", 305-pounder in to lead the way?
Big number 47, Eddie Vanderdoes, does it all. Not only does he play on the line, but also he plays a fullback. Now, we go back. Kenny Clark, number 97, was back there as well. Those are two big 300-pound athletic men back there leading for you with Paul Perkins.
Here's another defender. Miles Jack breaks a tackle, and another down to the one on his first carry of the season.
And he's saying, give it to me again. Keep me in. Keep feeding me. And this is just smash-mouth football right here. Again, Kenny Clark, Eddie Vanderdoes leading the way. I don't think Trey Nicholson doesn't want any part of the 300-pound lineman coming after
would
him.
Would you? Second and goal is Jack again. He's in. Touchdown, UCLA.
This was essentially the same play that just ran a snap ago. Miles Jack just cuts it up to getting in the end zone, but UCLA just basically saying, hey, we're going to put this ball in the end zone whether you like it or not.
Yeah. You use half our defense to do it.
And how explosive is Miles Jack? I mean, the few touches he had last year as a running back, taking them in for touchdowns.
68 carries now in his career, Brady, 11 of them for touchdowns. Here's his first one this season, and UCLA has opened up a two-score lead in the opener at the Rose Bowl. Eight of those 11 plays were running plays, including the capper, one-yard touchdown run from Miles Jack.
It's a bad, bad man, that Miles Jack. Just explosive and nasty. I think he likes defense better because he can be the hammer, not the nail.
Yeah.
He's punishing even when he's running the football running back.
Somebody asked him one time what he considers himself, and while he did admit he prefers defense, he said, I just consider myself a football player, man. Mizell going nowhere. Virginia backed into its own end to begin this possession. Time for a game break now, Jenny Taft.
Thanks, Joe. Cal hosting Grambling State after a couple Pac-12 upsets today. A better start for the Golden Bears as the Jonathan Williams pass is intercepted by Cameron Walker, returns it for the touchdown. Cal now up 21-0 early in this one. Joe.
All right, Jenny and Brady, that's a team to watch out for there in Cal.
Yeah, they can put a lot of points on the board. Jared Goff will be graduating after this year and looking on to the NFL. He'll be one of the top prospects coming out in next year's draft. Incredibly accurate, smart player. So they'll be in contention there in the Pac-12 North, in particular when Stanford lost today versus Northwestern.
So from inside their own 10, Matt Johns under pressure gets rid of it, but thrown well behind Andre Lavroni. Second down and 10 coming up. This Virginia team's going to have to open things up.
Yeah, you're starting to feel the momentum here in the stadium really shift towards UCLA, and UVA's got to start, you know, throwing the football downfield more. You know, Andre Lavroni a year ago was really the guy to provide some momentum for this offense and get them back into the game versus UCLA. They tried to target him there, but the pressure then is what comes into play because now you're more predictable. You're just throwing the football, and UCLA is going to pin their ears back and come after the quarterback.
Bit of a dangerous spot for Virginia. Already down two scores. Now backed into their own end. Johns throwing the slant. There is Lavroni, who heard footsteps from Young and dropped the football. Third down.
Yeah, tight coverage being played by UCLA on the outside. Simple slant route by Lavroni. And you don't have time in that quick game to double clutch the ball. You got to catch it cleanly and tuck it because there's going to be a guy flowing to you and get ready to hit you. Third and long again. Backed up like this, got to be careful. Can't have a turnover here. That really puts your defense in a hard position.
Johns takes off, and this is exactly what Jim Mora talked about to Chris at halftime. They couldn't have beat him.
This was what Matt Johns did last year versus UCLA that really sparked the offense, utilized his legs. He's not a dual threat quarterback, but he's athletic enough to take advantage of the opportunities when they're there. There should have been someone left back at home for Matt Johns, but both guys ran with the running back once he released out in the backfield. And that's what UVA needs right now. They need someone like Matt Johns to kind of turn the momentum here in the stadium, and a quarterback scramble for a first down is one way of doing it.
That's a huge play. They were looking at having a punt out of their own end zone. Instead, first and 10 from the 23. Not much for Reed. Jaleel Wadu, who's listed second on the depth chart at safety, he's been all over the place today.
And you see UVA still running the football, not giving up on it. They know that's probably their best way of being able to take a shot downfield is off that play-action pass. And look, there's still plenty of time left. There's 6:20 left in the third quarter. Down two scores, but no reason to stop trying to run the football. And maybe Smoke Mizell breaks open in a big run at some point here.
It's been a quiet second half for Mizell so far after he was the main cog in the first half of the Cavaliers. John steps up over the middle. Butts makes the reception. That ball was tipped midair, and the redshirt freshman tight end adjusted to pull it in.
And again, all possible by Matt Johns being able to step up and find room in the pocket. Just enough space. And then Evan Butts is able to get his hands on it and corral it in.
That's not easy.
No, butts with good hands. But you haven't heard that before, have you?
No, no. Anatomy's all thrown off. Now Virginia taking its time. They've moved the ball out of their own end and have it first and 10 at the 40. Here is Mizell. Able to cut it upfield. There's a solid gain of 7 on first down.
The fullback Vincent Croce leading the way. That big 6'4", 260-pound frame. It's nice to be able to run behind a guy like that. And again, you see that this is what they'd like to do. They want to control the possession of the football, not turn it over, not try to have any penalties, and be able to still maintain that balance. That's what makes this offense most effective, because when it comes down to it, UCLA on both sides of the ball has more talent.
Yeah.
So then it comes about better execution. This is how UVA plays.
They motion Croce out of the backfield wide. So John's all alone, throwing it down the sideline, and it's picked off! It was Marcus Rios with the interception.
Matt Johns trying to take a shot downfield, but Marcus Rios able to come up with a big pick. We need to look at two things here in the last interception. Marcus Rios up top, matched up on Canyon Severin, and a Darius Pickett at safety. Rios does a good job of jamming Severin, pushing him out of bounds, and then Pickett does a nice job reading the quarterback's eyes and coming over to make the play. It was great defense really by the secondary for UCLA. Look at how physical the corners are for UCLA, and Pickett there just kind of the play. I mean, Canyon Severin would have had to reestablish himself anyways back in bounds to catch that football.
This is Bolu Olorunfunmi, a freshman with a first down run, his first opportunity to carry it. The guy that Jim Morris says is his sleeper recruit. Wasn't highly recruited, but they like what they got from him.
Yeah, they call him a bit of a bowling ball because he just puts his foot in the ground and runs downhill. And he was impressive. And one of those guys who, again, came in, things didn't click right away, and then all of a sudden, the lights turned on.
There's a strike down the seam. Inside the 10, first down and goal. Kenny Walker, who dropped that ball on the first play of the game, pulls this one in. But a flag down in the backfield.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 55 defense. Half the distance to the goal from the end of the play, first down.
And it doesn't get much better than that for Josh Rosen. Timing up a play action fake with a post route, putting it right on the money. You see David Dean hitting Josh Rosen after the play. And that's only going to tack on a few more yards. And it seems inevitable UCLA is going to work it in the end zone. They've been pretty efficient so far with their red zone offense.
Perkins back in, a running back. More traditional look than the last time they were down here. Mike Moore swallows him up. The line of scrimmage, second down.
Wouldn't mind seeing that power. Looks like they're bringing it in.
Yeah.
They're bringing back the big boys.
It's not messing around.
That power
anymore,
running
right?
game. It's just fun to see defensive players get their opportunity on the offensive side of the ball.
And
you really get an appreciation what type of athletes these guys are.
Clark and Vanderdoes in the game. Jack taking the fake. Rosen making the throw for another UCLA touchdown. And that is Kenny Clark, who worked into the flats for it. A defensive tackle with a touchdown.
6'3", 310 pounds, but they said he's got great hands. There's a little bit of a misdirection in the backfield, but then Kenny Clark's going to slide out in the flat. And, of course, with that formation, everyone on the UVA sideline and on their defenses think it's going to be a run. Who would think he'd be somebody here? Defensive tackle coming out of the backfield.
He's on the PAT team as well. Fairbairn knocks it through, and UCLA takes. You know, the Bruins can finally breathe some, huh? Starting to feel it.
Yeah, I mean, then they really look like the team to beat right now in the Pac-12. And obviously still a ton of football to be played, but if they can get this type of quarterback play from Josh Rosen all season long, look out. You got to believe they'll be contending for the Pac-12, definitely a college football playoff spot.
So you're already making that call, team to beat in the Pac-12.
I'm not going to say it's a little bit too early for that, but if they can play this way, of course.
Well, be sure to huddle up with college football experts and live web chats all season long. A new guest every week, the Edward Jones College Football Huddle on FoxSports.com. Pac-12 is just loaded, though.
They really are, and in particular the Pac-12 South. And I really felt like after last season when it was all said and done, you look at their success in bowl season. I mean, the Pac-12 South was the best division in college football. People always wanted to hype up the SEC West, and you know they're another talented conference, but when it came down to bowl season, the SEC West struggled versus other conferences. And that's the neat thing about games like this early in the year. You get to see an ACC team versus the Pac-12 team and the differences in style of play.
Another first down run for Virginia. Howard Reed crosses the 30. It's been pretty predictable on first down.
Yeah, and it's tough as a quarterback. Believe me, I've been there before. When you get into a rhythm of a run, pass, you know, you really can't get into a sense or influence of throwing on first and second down, where sometimes that's where you see the best opportunities to throw the football.
Mizell takes the fake, now waits in the flats. Johns will flip it to him. And I believe that they ruled that that was a backwards pass that is just now ruled out of bounds. Did the line judge not blow the whistle until UCLA threw it out of bounds?
He did not. In fact, one of the officials backed up to see if anyone was going to recover it.
Now, I believe it would be UCLA's football
ball,
because they possessed it and then threw it. If they rule that Virginia was never out of bounds.
Yeah, I think Miles Jack was the player who picked it up. That's why they coach you. You say anytime a football is on the ground, pick it up. You never know. A lot of times you've got another assignment or you're trying to shed a block to get to the tackle the ball carrier, and all of a sudden the ball's on the ground.
So you got a couple things here. Was it or was it not a backwards pass? And so a fumble. Let's see.
It's tough to tell because Smoke Mizell moves his body upfield, and then that angle doesn't necessarily give us the best vantage point to see whether or not it was lateral. It looks like it the way his body moved, and I don't know if this is going to help us anymore either.
Now see if the ball ever goes out of bounds. No,
it stays in.
The ruling on the field was a backwards pass by Virginia, which was deflected forward. It was picked up by UCLA player, tossed forward out of bounds. It's a 5-yard penalty from the spot where he tossed it, and it will be UCLA's ball, first down.
Well done by Jerry Maggiannis giving the explanation. Bruin football.
That was a mouthful.
Yeah. Let's bring in our rules expert now, Mike Pereira, to help us sort through that one.
Yeah, interesting play, and I think they first got to go back now, if replay wants to get involved, to see if the first pass was indeed forward or backwards, because that is reviewable. And if, in fact, it is forward, then, the ball then would revert back to Virginia. He would be on the line, and he'd be penalized 5 yards, but they would still retain possession. And I'm sure that's what they're reviewing.
And this is really a critical play when it comes down to it. I mean, you're talking about UCLA, the way they've been scoring in the second half, getting the football back in plus territory. And being able to almost, I don't want to say put this game away, but that doesn't leave much hope that they get the ball the way they've been playing right now.
Yeah, the question is there indisputable video evidence that that was a forward pass? It's ruled backwards on the field. Ball leaves his hand at the, 31?
Yeah, again, it's really tough to tell the way Mizell moves upfield, but if you look at where it hits his hand, it looks closer to the down marker for actually where the ball was initially spotted, so this might be the best angle.
I think it's slightly forward.
I think it is as well, but again,
do you have it up?
Yeah, it has to be indisputable based on what the call was.
Mike, what do you think?
You know, and you got it right when you're talking about the reference point. So it's where it leaves the quarterback hand, his hand, to where it first touches anything. I kind of have the feeling that it is forward. But remember, one of the things that the book says, it has to be absolutely certain in college football, beyond a shadow of a doubt. And even looking at the line feed, the very first shot, you know, it looks like the ball leaves his hands right at the 31, and then the receiver reaches back. So it's a tight one, and I'm not so sure there's enough they can overturn it, but it's certainly close.
Here's that look he's talking about.
And Matt Johns does a nice job avoiding the pressure, using his legs. I mean, my advice is just turn it upfield.
The one they just showed.
Try to get the first down and get down. Obviously not take a hit, but flipping it to the sideline, not really much room to run anyways. Not sure what the thought process was there. Trying to flip it to Smoke Mizell.
How about the rule book getting a little bit poetic, beyond a shadow of a doubt?
Look at that haircut for Miles Jack.
Nice.
Is that the new style these days, Joe?
I'll let you try it out. It could be a better look. You're closer to that than I am at this point.
It's not the flowing locks I used to have.
After review, the ball went forward and hit the ground. It's an incomplete pass. The ball goes back to Virginia. It'll be third and three from the 32-yard line. There is no foul for an illegal forward pass on UCLA. Third down. Please reset the game clock to 3 minutes, 16 seconds. 3 minutes, 16 seconds, and it will start on the snap.
All right, Mike, that seems like good work all around by this crew.
Yeah, I think it was, and the fact that it was not an illegal forward pass for Virginia because he did release the ball prior to reaching the 32-yard line. In order for his pass to be illegal, his whole body and the ball would have had to be beyond the line at the point of release. So good job getting that sorted out. But I do think you can see ball released at 31, touch beyond at almost the 32. Good decision in replay.
All right, Mike, we appreciate the help. Third down. Virginia trying to take advantage of the overturn call. Johns got rid of it, incomplete. Wanted Mizell, who it looked like he got held on to, but no call. And it's fourth down.
Yeah, Steve Fairchild tried to diagram one up there for Smoke Mizell coming in motion. Miles Jack, nice coverage.
Randall Goforth, the injured player. He missed almost all of last season with shoulder injuries. Had surgery on both after just the second game.
And he's a significant piece of the secondary for UCLA. A good open field tackler. Comes down into the box and makes some plays in the running game. Physical player for his size. Not the biggest, but definitely is aggressive and sticks his nose in to stop the run and help out. Ooh.
Yeah, good to see him walking off on his own power.
Yeah.
Part of the return game right now, too, with Ishmael Adams out. Devin Fuller will go back to return this punt. Nicholas Conti has had a good debut to his Virginia career. Won the battle in camp with James Coleman. He's boomed a couple today. It's a fake, and it's a first down. So not just a couple of nice punts from Conti, but a fake punt that moves the chains and for the time being keeps Virginia believing.
Yeah, Larry Lewis, the special teams coordinator, sees something he liked in that spread out punt formation, and with 33, not much to go, didn't have to ask too much of his punter. But this might be the spark UVA needs to try to, you know, get a drive together, get another score, try to get back into this ball game.
So twice it looked like UCLA was going to take the ball, and twice Virginia keeps it, once on the overturn call and now on the fake punt. So here's a first down pass call. Johns feeling the pressure, eyes downfield, dangerous throw is incomplete. Coverage from Wadu. And it's second down and 10. You look for the tight end, Hopkins.
And Hopkins, the graduate out of Stanford, trying to find a way to get open, but those big boys don't move quite as quick as the safety, Jaleel Woodard. Good play by the sophomore.
Woodard's had a good game. Breaks that one up, makes it second and 10.
Good to see the mix-up by UVA, though, passing on first
right
down.
A pass on second down as well. John's feeling the heat. Throws it away. That's five consecutive incompletions. But like you talked about, hard to have much rhythm with the way things have gone.
It's hard to get into a rhythm. And even on top of that, you know, credit the secondary for UCLA and really the front four. Getting pressure on Matt Johns. He's done a nice job of evading pressure and getting outside the pocket. But it really hasn't been much, you know, for him downfield.
Started the game 13 for 16. He's completed just one of his last eight, third and 10.
I suspect they'll try to work to Kanan Severin. Bottom of your screen in the slot.
Edge pressure. Ball's tipped and incomplete. Once again, they do it with just four.
And that's the advantage this UCLA defense has compared to the UVA defense. They're able to just rush four and still get pressure on Matt Johns. Looked like he was going to Kanan Severin up the seam, and Severin had a step. The UCLA defense doing too good a job of getting penetration, getting their hands up to bat down the football.
So Nicholas Conte had a brief moment of glory there on the fake punt back out there to punt it. Fuller watches it bounce, takes a good Virginia roll down to the knot. And that's where UCLA will head back to the field with a three-touchdown advantage. And Josh Rosen, true freshman starting quarterback. Ton of hype around this kid coming in. You look at the guys recently, some of the notable true freshman quarterbacks to move into a starting role. Only nine times since the turn of the century has a true freshman quarterback led a team to a top 25 finish. So he's trying to buck the trend.
Yeah, I mean, and look, you're going to go through a physical development and mental development playing at a higher level of football. So it's hard for a lot of times for a true freshman to have success. But look, with this talented team with as much experience out around him, I think Josh Rosen is very much prepared and able to lead this team, at least how he's looked so far in his first game.
Handed off to Jamabo, second down. How ready were you when you were thrown into the fire as a true freshman?
Yeah, I mean, I think, look, you're as ready as you can be and as much as you prepare. Nowadays, high school systems do a nice job of preparing these players to be able to go right in and fit in some of these college systems.
Completes one to Jordan Payton. Runs through Canada to make it third and short.
And it also takes a good offensive coordinator like Noel Mazzoni, who works towards the strengths of his quarterback, simplifying things, just allowing him to do the things that he's good at, running the football, taking some pressure off his shoulders.
Trying to run for the first down, and it looks like Jamabo did get it off. Landing and Kaiser with a tackle, but not before. Let's see where they spot it. Simple off the measure.
Jamabo, a five-star recruit at Plano West High School down there in Plano, Texas. He's a big boy.
Yeah.
6'3", 210 pounds as a freshman. Looked like with his forward progress he had gotten the first down.
And got to buy plenty. You mentioned highly touted coming out of high school for Jamabo. The coaching staff said that it's a bit of a slow start to his first fall camp, but then something clicked and they started seeing the guy that they knew they recruited.
And sometimes that's all it takes. It takes one moment in practice or maybe just the advice from an older player like maybe Paul Perkins to get you going.
Rosen over the middle and caught. For another first down.
Looks like Logan Sweet, fifth-year senior out of Mission Viejo.
Well, they play a ton of guys at receiver, don't they?
He's almost completed to 10 different wide receivers and, a defensive lineman if you include the touchdown pass to Clark.
He pumps on the short route and off of the double move. A deep ball is thrown perfectly inside the 30, first down.
If you remember earlier in the game, Josh Rosen overthrew Jordan Payton on the same route. They called a sluggo. This time, he puts enough air and trajectory to complete it for the big gain and first down. We're watching Josh Rosen continue to get better, even just in the course of this game.
Found Jordan Payton that time. First time he's gone downfield to him. Jamabo pulled down by Kaiser, but got five, and it's second down to bring this third quarter to a close. What a day it's been for UCLA and for Josh Rosen. It's 25-32, and the Bruins start the cruise in their opener. ...26 of 33 for more than 300 yards and a couple of touchdowns for the true freshman Josh Rosen.
What a day. What a day.
First true freshman to start a game for UCLA in 13 seasons. Hangs that one up there and gets bailed out by Sweet. Went up and pulled it down against Wahi. Just shy of the marker, third down and one.
Look at the hit by Wilfred Wahi. This UVA defense isn't giving up. They're still laying the wood. They're still competing.
And now this one sails into the backfield. Rosen has to go back to fall on it at the 32-yard line.
This is sometimes what happens with a younger, inexperienced guy. He's clapping, not looking for the football, though. Brindle, the center, thinks he's ready for it, so he snaps it. Again, that's just something that, as a young player, it'll work out the communication with your center. And I'm sure they'll fix that on the sidelines here as they will come out eventually again for another series.
Yeah, this one is officially 49 for Kaimi Fairbairn, and it would be a career long. And he's continued to struggle on the longer distance attempts. His first miss today, and it remains 31-9. The opening minute of this fourth quarter. So Virginia's offense back to the field. Not much room for air left in this one. Three-score game, fourth quarter. By Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And sponsored by Nissan. Go to NissanHeismanHouse.com to cast your official vote for the next Heisman. And by Bud Light. Stay in the game and drink responsibly. Early fourth quarter, just outside of Los Angeles in Pasadena. Matt Johns in this Virginia offense. Three times had to settle for field goals and now facing a three-score deficit as Albert Reed gets popped. Jack was there with Anku. What's Virginia got to do to have a shot to make a late run?
Well, they got to start throwing the football.
Yeah.
I mean, you're down too many scores, and at this point in the fourth quarter, running the football is only going to take more time off the clock, and you're not really hitting those home runs you'd hope for. So you got to start opening it up, allow Matt Johns to try to stretch the field with his arm and then still make plays with his legs. That doesn't appear to be what UVA's built for.
Another run play, shut down again. Ely Anku, back-to-back plays, and it's third down.
And this is hard for, you know, a quarterback in his fourth career start to, again, have to be in the rhythm of constantly running the ball, and then being put in third and eight, third and nine, third and ten. You'd like to see yourself a little closer to the sticks where you can incorporate more of your playbook. You know, and at this point, UCLA knows you're going to throw the football. UVA knows you got to. And it's tough to actually be able to convert and continue to move the chains when you have to in situations like this.
Third down and long, a familiar spot for the Cavaliers today. The twist up front, got pressure on him, but he got rid of it to Hopkins. Right at the first down marker. This will depend on the spot.
Charlie Hopkins, the Stanford graduate, transfers over. He needed to get a couple yards, or at least a yard past the sticks. He had to come back to the football in order to secure the catch, but in this case, you'd hate that they'd come up short. And brings the question, with the ball close to midfield, at this point in the game, do you go for it on fourth down?
You mentioned that he's a Stanford transfer. Two catches while he was at Stanford. One of them came against UCLA. And this one is enough. What was a pretty generous spot, perhaps, from this officiating crew.
as he comes back to secure the catch. I mean, I don't know that he got that ball before our third down marker. Where the line was, but nevertheless, UVA staying on the field. There's still some hope.
They've run it on first down 5 of the last 6 times. Let's see what they do here from the 42. John steps up in the pocket and goes down. Young was there with McKinley after a short gain, second down.
Yeah, but that's okay. Look, Matt Johns drops back, feels the pressure, steps up, doesn't take a sack, gets upfield for a 2-yard gain. I mean, look, this is the situation he's going to have to be in the rest of the game. And he's athletic enough to handle it. And it's not as if he's taking a sack. He's done a good job moving his feet, moving around the pocket, and finding some positives in some of these bleak scenarios with the way UCLA has been able to bring pressure.
Second down and 8 rolls out with his eyes downfield, zipping one to the sideline, diving attempt. And it is pulled in by Andre Lavroni. I know bottom line right now doesn't look good for Virginia, but some things to be happy with.
Oh, definitely. I mean, you're looking at Matt Johns and the way he's played. Basically, one bad decision where, you know, really, again, being down all game for the most part, besides the 3-0 lead, he took one shot, ends up throwing an interception. Besides that, he's played extremely well. I mean, they've got to feel comfortable that Matt Johns will only continue to get better and the group of wide receivers around him will.
So short side, back-to-back catches, Lavroni. This one for 7, second down and 3. It took about a half minute between the time that the ball was spotted and the time they ran that play.
Yeah, they're really trying to pick up the pace. Obviously, they have to at this point, given being down by 22 points. But you can see it, right? Andre Lavroni starting to develop into another viable option to actually... Matt Johns threw his first touchdown too last year versus UCLA right before half.
Said they'd like to pick up the pace. They need to. Still huddling and taking their time breaking it. Smoke Mizell pulled down by Moreau. And it'll be third down after a game break with Jenny Taft.
Joe, thank you. BYU visiting Nebraska. The Cornhuskers taking the lead in the third with this play. Tommy Armstrong finding Trey Foster for the 9-yard score. That's Armstrong's third TD today. Nebraska up 28-24. Joe?
All right, Jenny, Brady, you and I and Chris will be back out here in 2 weeks when BYU comes to the Rose Bowl to take on UCLA.
Yeah, excited to see Taysom Hill. Quite the force as far as a dual threat quarterback. Tough guy to bring down. Reminds me of a right-handed Tim Tebow.
Yeah. They motion Albert Reed all the way to the sideline. Johns throws underneath, incomplete, too low for Mizell. Fourth down. You would assume it will go. The offense does remain out there. Down 3 scores inside of 10 minutes.
And if you're Tom Bradley, the defensive coordinator for UCLA, he has the luxury of basically dropping 7 guys in coverage. And being able to still rush and get pressure on Matt Johns with their front 4. So tough scenario here.
Converted their 1 fourth down try today. Here on 4th and 2. Johns got hit. Incomplete. And Johns slow getting up.
Looks like Matt Dickerson coming in and laying the wood. Matt Johns had no chance on that particular play. That'll be first down UCLA when we come back. That last sack, we got left guard Jack McDonald with Matt Dickerson right over top of him. And at the snap of the ball, for whatever reason, Jack McDonald turns to take over on Kenny Clark, the nose. And just hangs Matt Johns out to dry.
Not a good feeling.
No, and it could have easily been roughing the passer as Matt Dickerson drives Matt Johns into the ground.
Jerry Neuheisel comes into the game at quarterback for UCLA and got a good ovation from this crowd who's appreciated what he's done in his career and appreciated the way that he handled losing the job to Josh Rosen this year.
Yeah, and they talked a little bit about, a guy who's in a heated competition, be the starting quarterback at the university. But Jerry Neuheisel still helped him out, still tried to share a little bit of the playbook with him.
That's Jamabo. The freshman breaks free. Heck of a run inside the 40. 26 yards, showing flashes of what made him a top recruit.
Well, you got to love the fact that a running back, when he gets into the sidelines, doesn't look to run out of bounds. He turned it back into the UVA defense and looked for more yards and more contact.
Hold a run from me. Bobbles it and incomplete. Couple of talented freshmen rotating in at running back. Speaking of freshmen, this is how Josh Rosen's debut looked.
I mean, extremely efficient. Was very accurate. The football made great decisions all day. I mean, I can't really even pinpoint one particular play where you look at him and go, oh, that was a freshman mistake. I mean, all around, just a tremendous debut.
Flag comes in.
False start, offense, number 20. 5-yard penalty, second down.
That 3-touchdown performance, by the way, for Rosen ties Cade McNown for the UCLA freshman record.
And, you know, we talked about his background growing up as a very successful young tennis player. A lot of times the accountability that comes with that, and it's only you out there. So when you lose or you make mistakes, you got to be the one to fix them. That bodes well for a quarterback because you're not going to be pointing fingers at the offensive line or anyone else.
Jamabo inside the 10, legs turning to the 4. 39 yards, and he had him to the equation with already Paul Perkins back there.
It's a scary future to think about Josh Rosen and So-So Jamabo coming out of the backfield. I mean, he's going to be biding for some playing time with Paul Perkins this year. Perkins obviously the lead back, but Jamabo will see some playing time.
So we'll hold a run from me. Takes it down to the 3.
UCLA has got a lot to be excited about in this program. They're building a new facility, one of which head coach Jim Moore has even put money into as far as improving their overall facilities here for their football team.
Well, Lorenz would be shut down. They just had the groundbreaking ceremony recently. The Wasserman Center in Westwood. We spent some time on campus the other day. Sure is a beautiful area.
And going back to Rosen, you know, I had a chance to speak with a strength coach, and something that gets overlooked, he has this tennis background, so people would think, oh, he's probably more of maybe a finesse player, he's a quarterback. And Sal Losey, the strength coach, says, no, this guy gets after, he's a closet meathead, in his words. And it was real, he felt he had a big impact on the offensive line and some of the bigger guys as far as how hard he worked in the weight room.
That's like the ultimate compliment from a strength coach, right? Closet
yeah,
meathead.
Without a doubt.
Big time pressure against Neuheisel, who will throw it away. And fourth down coming up.
Smart decision there. You wouldn't expect anything else from a coach's son, right? Just get rid of it. Save yourself the opportunity to get points.
Corny and Wahi with the pressure. Good looking drive, but they'll have to settle for a field goal attempt. This is a clean extra point for Kaimi Fairbairn, and he knocks it through. His second make today, and the score is 34-9. Fox Sports College Football is presented by GEICO, and UCLA has dominated this second half to pull away minutes within win number 1. How'd it go?
I got up on the board for about half a second, fell, and almost got my head taken off by the, what do they call it, a riptide?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Surfboard came right across my head, and I thought, probably shouldn't be doing this.
Yeah, hence one time. That's why.
maybe not go
by
yourself.
The water, too.
Yeah. Shark-infested waters down there.
Stay out of there. Fairbairn just nailed his second field goal of the day. And a strong leg gets it into the back of the end zone. Time for another game break. Checking with Jenny Taft.
Joe, how about Penn State Temple in Philly? The Nittany Lions have not lost to the Owls since 1941. That may change today. Jihad Thomas for the 24-yard run. Temple 24, Penn State 10. Joe, back to you.
Wow. Huh, there's some big surprises today.
Yeah, and in particular, you know, Christian Hackenberg, one of the most talented quarterbacks when you look at his overall skill set and arm strength and all of that, but he just has not continue to improve the way you'd want him to as far as understanding their offense and implementing it into a game. A bit of a surprise there, but Temple's got a solid defense as well. Nothing to bat an eye at.
2 yards from Mizell on first down. Some of the twos into the game for UCLA defensively. A chance to get some more guys time. They are deep, so these are guys that will contribute as the year goes on. 34-9 UCLA. John's off play action. Perfectly thrown to Cannon Severin near midfield. Johns continues to do good things when given the opportunity.
Yeah, I mean, you see whenever they utilize the play action pass, they're usually able to get something from it. Now, Matt Johns rushed them to the line of scrimmage, but this might be a little too late. They needed more of this on first down and second down earlier in the game.
Good surge this time to lead the way for Albert Reed. 6 or 7 for the Maryland transfer.
I think UVA's got to feel good about the way Matt Johns has conducted himself today. I mean, they've continually moved the ball for the most part. There hasn't been many three and outs. I think him and Kaden Severin have something to hang their hat on as far as their connection. Andre Lavroni, another guy who's connected with them on another time. And really, Charlie Hopkins providing something in the passing game at tight end.
They'll take on Notre Dame next week back home as Mizell runs for close to a first down. UCLA, meanwhile, with big-time expectations again. They go on the road to Vegas before returning here and starting a really tough stretch with BYU.
Yeah, and for me, you know, it's the road games in the Pac-12 that are so tough on UCLA's schedule. They go to at Arizona September 26th, October 15th, they're at Stanford. And then they're playing Cal the following week. I don't think it's going to be any pushover in the Pac-12 this year. They go to at Oregon State. Oregon State's been known to pull off some upsets throughout the past few years. And then you've got at Utah, at USC to finish the season. I mean, those are tough places to play.
John's even one downfield over Severin's head. Second down. UCLA has not beaten Stanford under Coach Mora.
This year may be the year, though. You know, they lose 9 guys on defense.
Oregon, the other team that's been a thorn in the side of Coach Mora.
They don't have the plan this year.
Right.
Yeah, and then they're still trying to figure out their quarterback situation, whether it's Jeff Lockie or Vernon Adams. That was an interesting matchup today, too. Vernon Adams transfers from Eastern Washington.
Yeah.
And guess who they play week one?
Yeah.
Eastern Washington.
Boys from the red turf. On second down, Johns hits Mizell, angling out of the backfield inside the 25 for first down. You think it's hard to watch Boise State on TV? Have you ever watched Eastern Washington at home?
I couldn't imagine trying to play a team on blue turf, and there's all blue uniforms, the blue helmet. I mean,
the Eastern Washington is red jerseys on red turf.
I couldn't imagine. That would be difficult. It's difficult for us to see, but it'd be difficult to be, you know, playing with, trying to see all the defense, too. It's as fast as the game's played.
Hard to look at, but you know Boise State for the blue turf, and a lot of people know Eastern Washington for the red turf. That's Colin Cowherd's alma mater, by the way. Eastern Washington. Johns floats one out to Croce, who's tackled quickly.
What I love about that pass, though, is Matt Johns understands who he's throwing to. It's a fullback. You know, again, a converted defensive lineman to fullback. Doesn't have the best hands, but he throws a ball with touch.
Yeah.
It's on the money, on time, with touch. And I really like what I see from both quarterbacks. I mean, Johns isn't obviously a true freshman, but, again, he's a guy who's young in his career, starting out with only 4 career starts, and hopefully someone at UVA can keep in the system for a while and not have transfer out.
Throwing back from Mizell, who makes the adjustment for the touchdown. Taquan Mizell has had a nice day, and he's got a 19-yard touchdown, the first Virginia touchdown of the year.
And we've seen a ton of misdirection today with Matt Johns booting out from under center. And in this particular case, he rolls out to the right, and Mizell kind of just slips out onto a wheel route down the left sideline. Kind of catches UCLA sleeping, and Matt Johns does a nice job of throwing up a ball where Mizell could adjust to.
Mizell now with 100 yards receiving today. And a 34-16 score now late in the fourth quarter. But Mizell in Virginia with some reasons to be happy about how some things went. Presented by Geico, is sponsored by AT&T, mobilizing your world. Back of the Rose Bowl. And how about our Nissan Heisman watch? Still early in the year, right? But we're going to let you know who Brady thinks at this point should be part of that discussion.
Yeah, obviously you see Boykin, Kessler, Nick Chubb, outstanding running back at Georgia, and Connor Cook, quarterback for Michigan State. But at Ohio State is a question mark, because if J.D. Barrett starts, I think he's got the better chance of winning the Heisman at Ohio State. But if Cardale Jones starts, they're going to run the football more, and it might be Ezekiel Elliott,
yeah,
their outstanding running back. So it kind of changes, but someone's going to possibly come out as a front runner at Ohio State.
Mossy Johnson lost that ball on the way to the ground. We'll see who comes out of the pile with it.
One of the new rules they instituted was there was a personal foul. For pulling guys off, yeah, of the pile, they feel like that's a way of instigating a fight and continuing to allow that stuff to happen. A lot of times when there's a loose football, you see that.
UCLA did recover.
Ball's definitely out.
Yeah.
All in the name of player safety, though, right?
Yeah, exactly. And so 3:21 to go. And before they snap it, here's
the
whistle.
The previous play is under further review.
So they're going to take a look at this. To see if there wasn't a clear Virginia recovery.
Which is now reviewable. But I don't know if anything from that replay would be able to tell you right there.
Yeah, it's got to be a clear cut recovery to overturn it.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. UCLA's ball, first down.
Which would have been big. I mean, yeah, obviously still a three-score game, but you don't onside kick there, but you end up getting the sum of what an onside,
right,
kick would have end up being. Obviously not the case.
Neuheisel and Jamabo back out there to form UCLA's backfield. Had an impressive drive last time out that ended in a field goal. And this one starts for the Jamabo run. Sure seems like he's a strong kid, huh?
Yeah, you know, it's tough for a lot of those taller running backs. 6'1", 6'2", 6'3", you got those long legs. It's usually pretty tough for you to be physical. So Jamabo is able to find a way to get his pad level down. He's really a physical runner, running through tackles. Almost reminds you a little bit of Adrian Peterson, the way he almost looks to turn it back in for more contact and punishes the defense on his way upfield.
6'3", 210 is a true freshman.
And he's only going to fill out from there and become more explosive.
Here he is again. Blanding finished him off. Dante Wilkins there as well.
Andrew Brown, defensive tackle number 9. Got in there some penetration early to kind of stop the run. He was Gatorade State Player of the Year back in 2013. And has since then been nagged by injuries. But it's just a ton of talent. Now he's trying to fit into a scheme with Johnson Uter that requires certain specifics, in particular in defensive front, staying in your gap, using gap integrity, not just going out there and doing your own thing.
Got into really good shape in the offseason with a rigorous boxing routine. He did for his regular workout. That one moves the chains inside of 2 minutes. And a UCLA player a bit slow getting to his feet.
UCLA fans have a lot to be excited for this season. A lot of times you don't necessarily know how a team's going to be in their opening game. If you go back and look at TCU, for example, number 2 team in the country, kind of came out a little bit flat up in Minnesota. Game was closer than many thought. because of all the talent for TCU, but this UCLA Bruin team has a ton of depth, a ton of talent, a lot of experience. That is a dangerous combination. You have a quarterback like Josh Rosen who completes 80% of his balls.
How about the Dr. Pepper one-of-a-kind play of the game? Duarte on the reception. Rosen's throw is right there. Our Dr. Pepper play of the game. So plenty of reasons to be excited. And, you know, we talked about it coming into the game. Sure, it's a question mark because he'd never played a game, but he was the most highly anticipated debut of any freshman player in the country this year, and we got to see exactly why today.
Yeah, and you see why so many people are high on UCLA. You know, they've been able to see Josh Rosen and his arm strength, his ability, how accurate he is with the football. He didn't come in with any flaws in his throwing motion. He came in basically physically ready to play and mentally. You're talking about a smart kid, honor roll guy coming out of high school. I mean, he was very easily able to adapt to the college game and everything that entails as an early enrollee.
And we talked to Jim Moore earlier this week. He hedged his bet a bit. He said this kid, you know, he's got all the physical tools. He's got the emotional and the mental side. But, and he said, you know, bold, italicized, underlined, big but. It'll be his first game as a true freshman. But he passed every test.
Yeah, and he actually compared it to, you know, Brett Hundley's first start, some of the anxiety that went into that. But that was in part because it was his first start as well, his first game as well as head coach of UCLA. Not the case here. Only question mark was how would Rosen play, and he played outstanding.
34-16, the final. We'll be back to put a capper on it all at the Rose Bowl on the other side.